An analysis between the German warrior poet Ernst Jünger and the British Christian apologist and writer C.S. Lewis interested me for several reasons. One is because, with two exceptions, I haven't found anywhere where Lewis and Jünger have been put into any sort of dialogue with each other. The first exception I found is a blog post, where the writer, Jordan Poss, briefly brings in a quote by C.S. Lewis on a post about Jünger, showing that they both believe that there is a natural religious instinct in man that can be oriented towards dangerous beliefs. The second exception came after a lot of digging online, where I found on a forum someone posting a short essay they wrote comparing C.S. Lewis and Ernst Jünger, but I haven't read it in order to not be influenced by it in my own analysis. Another thing drawing me to do this analysis is that I have found their biographies to have many parallelisms. Born not even 3 years apart from each other in the late 1890s, both of these men would go on to serve as frontline soldiers in their late teens and early 20s for their respective countries in World War I, both seeing combat in northeast France, on opposite sides of no man's land, of course. They would then also serve their countries in less action-packed ways during the Second World War as older men who were established in their careers and had already amassed fame. Immediately after World War I, Jünger would go on to become quite a public sensation in Germany with the publication of his memoirs of his war years called Storm of Steel, released in 1920, and he became an independent writer and would go on to write political tracts in an assortment of various political publications while also publishing fictional works. C.S. Lewis would likewise become a sort of public intellectual in Britain, but his stature wouldn't arise to legendary heights like Jünger's into the late 1930s and early 40s. And now, while he and Jünger both wrote widely successful fiction and non-fiction works that reached the broader public, there is much less emphasis on purely political topics in Lewis's corpus, and to this effect, C.S. Lewis remained rather aloof from the political movements of his day. Instead, he spent much of his time in academia in Oxford and later in Cambridge as a scholar of English literature. This, of course, isn't to say that Lewis never talked about politics or that there are no political strands in his work. Another interesting parallel is that both of these men converted to Christianity. Lewis came from a Christian family and then became an atheist in his teen years before becoming, once again, a Christian, specifically Anglican in his 30s, whereas Jünger was raised in an agnostic household and he wasn't baptized until he was 100 years old in the Catholic Church, although there was a lot of debate around his conversion, but ultimately only God knows what was in his heart. He died in 1998 at 102, having fought in both World Wars and having seen the Cold War in its entirety, whereas C.S. Lewis died relatively young, in 1963, at the age of 64. But what finally convinced me to talk about these two men was that they both have monographs on the subject of pain, written just years apart from each other. Ernst Jünger wrote his essay, On Pain, in 1934, and Lewis wrote The Problem of Pain in 1940, and it is significantly longer than Jünger's treatment. Lewis's book is a work of Christian apologetics, and he spends quite a bit of time defending Christianity in the book from what we now refer to as neckbeard atheist arguments, such as, can God create a rock so heavy he himself cannot lift it? Or, if God exists, how come bad things happen? And a whole other host of silly arguments we saw make a resurgence with the short-lived New Atheism movement. But rather than just knocking down these arguments to own the atheist, Lewis uses these questions as a foil to discuss the actual Christian message in a very profound, yet still accessible way in a manner that most Christians, including myself, would find acceptable even if they might quibble over some of the exact details. The main thrust of the book, as its title suggests, is to explicate what the Christian view towards pain is and why there is pain in the world. Lewis's answer is in part a reframing of the unbeliever's question of how the loving Christian God can allow a world with pain, suffering, and torment to exist by setting straight what Christianity, love, and God even are in the first place. For Lewis, this so-called objection of pain can only be raised if your definition of Christianity is that it's a viewpoint that's the conclusion of a philosophical debate on the origins of the universe, rather than what it truly is, namely, a catastrophic historical event following on the long spiritual preparation of humanity. Furthermore, Lewis corrects us as to what love really is. It's not what his fellow Englishmen of his time and many of our own 21st century contemporaries believe, which totally trivializes love to heartwarming sentiments towards other people and a wish to not upset them. No, Rather, love is, in part, the proper relationship between the creature and their creator, where the loving creator wants us to live and is willing to correct us when we have gone astray so that we may attain eternal life because he loves us. And now, Lewis demarcates two sources of pain. There is that pain which man causes to his fellow man, which Lewis estimates makes up 80% of all pain. To this sort of pain, the Christian can explain it in light of man's tendency towards sin and wickedness in light of the fall, which he understands in a very Augustinian way and makes no secret about it. But Lewis also tackles what is perhaps harder for the Christian to answer, namely that pain that is not immediately produced by man, and the pain we may say is allowed by God to exist, and as some unbelievers might say, would have to be directly caused by God, as if God is some occasionalist. Here, Lewis sets out a metaphysic of pain that is very similar to Jünger's definition of pain. Pain is something which we cannot ignore, and which shakes us to our very core. At the start of Jünger's work, he defines pain as the most difficult in a series of trials one is accustomed to calling life. Lewis offers several characteristics and definitions of pain throughout his much longer work, but I think his most succinct definition is found when he says, "Pain is not only immediately recognizable evil, but evil impossible to ignore. Pain insists upon being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks in our conscience, but shouts in our pains. It is his megaphone to rouse a deaf world." And now with this, Lewis is able to explain the meaning of pain. Pain is the result of the fall from paradise and into sin away from God. It is one of the ways that God speaks to us to remind us, who all too often believe that we have it all and have no need for God, that God is our life source. The pain that God allows to happen to us is not done out of hatred for humanity, but out of pure love, which we, in our pride, can often only hear through pain and suffering, because it is these things which shake us to our core and which can call us to draw closer to God. It serves as a crucible where our faith is tested, where our hearts and minds are purified, and where we can draw closer to the infinite goodness of God. For pain, he says, shatters the creature's false self-sufficiency, forcing us to rely on God, in which we thereby act from God in ourselves. We become collaborators in or life instruments of creation. Since we have this great calling as creatures of God, namely to be co-workers with God, and we know that pain and tribulation can help us on our journey to become closer to God, the problem of pain starts making sense. And since God is loving and doesn't want us to perish, but rather to become like him, Lewis says, that is why tribulation cannot cease until God either sees us remade or sees that our remaking is now hopeless. But Lewis goes even further with this, through reminding us that self-sacrifice, with martyrdom as its highest pinnacle of expression, is the essence of Christianity. And it is through self-sacrifice that the sacrifice of Christ is repeated or re-echoed among his followers in varying degrees, from the cruelest martyrdom down to his self-submission of intention, whose outward signs have nothing to distinguish them from the ordinary fruits of temperance and sweet reasonableness. This means that for Lewis, the problem of pain isn't solved because the so-called bad people need to experience pain for their own salvation. Instead, understanding the self-sacrificial nature of Christ, which all Christians are called to, the question then becomes, why do some pious Christians not suffer? On the surface, Ernst Jünger's essay on pain is much different than Lewis's work. Rather than a work of Christian apologetics, it is a work that is describing, seemingly with glee, the rise of a totalitarian metaphysics, with a special focus on how man's relationship to pain is evolving. Specifically, this work is almost a sequel, or perhaps a mere addendum due to its brevity, to Jünger's much longer and denser work entitled The Worker from 1932, which describes the rise of the figure of the dutiful, self-sacrificial, nationalistic worker in the age of technology, totalitarianism, and total mobilization after the First World War. Having read the work myself, the best way that I can describe it is through the feeling it gives after reading. It makes you want to take off your shirt and work a 12-hour night shift in a state-run armament factory while air raid sirens blare in the distance, almost something out of the socialist realism movement. On Pain is a much more accessible text, but no less rhapsodic or bombastic than The Worker. The very start reads, "There are several great and unalterable dimensions that show a man's stature. Pain is one of them. It is the most difficult in a series of trials one is accustomed to call life. Pain is one of the keys to unlock man's innermost being as well as the world." All this is said right before he slips into the second person, where you can almost hear the pages shouting at you, when he writes, "Tell me your relation to pain, and I'll tell you who you are." But we always have to be careful with Jünger, because there's always a sort of ironic veil that guards his work, and the is and the ought becomes very blurry. Even his New York Times obituary says that a frequent criticism of Mr. Jünger was that he registered events only at a cool distance, never passing judgment or injecting an emotional note. Jünger even brings this up in an interview at the age of 100 in 1995, where he noted how even his close friend, Carl Schmitt, and the great Oswald Spengler himself had been confused by this, since they both misunderstood the notion of the worker. "They misunderstood my intentions. Spengler and Schmitt did not accept my theses because they thought I wanted to sing the praises of the proletarian. I saw the worker as a kind of Promethean figure, not as a proletarian." Now, when it comes to On Pain, there are many cringe takes on this short text, and I want to make note here that the actual content written by Jünger in this book, from the 2008 Telos Press edition, is only 47 pages, whereas the preface and the translator's introduction combined total also to 47 pages. To make matters worse, these supplementary writings have been inserted into the front of the book as if to suggest that they should be read first. Gripes about modern historical reprinting customs aside, the preface and introduction miss, I believe, what this work is actually about. The preface, for instance, is a rather obnoxious read, for it's filled with all the neoconservative trappings of 2008, and it's filled with stale and strained references to Al-Qaeda, 9/11, and the War on Terror. Thankfully, the translator's introduction is a much more insightful read due to the historical and biographical detail it adds, but it still doesn't really make a bold thesis as to what the work is actually about. Which ultimately, I argue that this work is about an alternative modernity. And what I mean by this is that Jünger elucidates a modernity he sees rising, and it is proper to call it a modernity that's very different from the liberal modernity which has plagued us in the West for the past few hundred years. The modernity envisioned by Jünger was killed in its infancy with the capitalist communist, weird how things work out, alliance of the 1940s, and the last hope that existed in the Western mind to propose a different flavor of modernity was the modernity as envisioned by the Marxist, but even then, that hope was extinguished with the fall of the Soviet Union. Jünger's modernism is a modernism imbued with authoritarianism, militarism, nationalism, the ethnos, self-sacrifice, anti-humanism, and a Nietzschean view of life that says to strive for greatness rather than bourgeois notions of morality. As Jünger says in On Pain, the increasing objectification of life in the totalitarian age means that we may say technology is our uniform, making him far from a reactionary. There is no yearning for the past, only a radical embrace of a future, modern, but highly liberal age that is to come. I'll leave the great Jonathan Bowden, a self-ascribed right-wing Nietzschean, to put this succinctly.
I am a modernist in many ways, because I believe we created a modern world that has been taken away from what it could have been. The modern and that which preceded it are not necessarily in complete opposition. If people with our sorts of values ruled modernity, everything about this society would be at one level the same and in every other respect completely different. People would still drive, you know, contemporary cars, there'd still be jets, and there'd still be supercomputers and so on. But the texture and the nature of life would be different in every respect.
On Pain reveals the illiberal possibilities of modernity and how, in the interwar period, they were tapped into to create a radically illiberal path that, among many things, was radically changing man's relationship to pain, which is much more elemental than we are willing to admit. Something I believe he and C.S. Lewis would be in agreement on. Today, he says, we can say with some certainty that the world of the self-critical individual is over, and that its system of values, if no doubt still widespread, has been overthrown in all decisive points or refuted by its very own consequence. This is because of his twist on the philosophy of Friedrich Nietzsche and his notion of the last man, the archetype of a man who is content to merely live in comfort, avoiding all pain and by extension any higher human desires. Think here of the complacent men endorsed by utilitarian philosophers. The prophecy of the last man has found rapid fulfillment, Jünger admits. It is accurate, except for the assertion that the last man lives longest. His age already lies behind us. I believe the reason for his age, the last man's age, lying behind us, is explained with the experience of Jünger with the Great War, where bourgeois ideals of comfort become greatly disturbed. Like fellow modernist and great war veteran and writer Wyndham Lewis, no relation to C.S. Lewis, although they were both British contemporaries, the Great War for these men was much more than just a war, and again, I'll leave Jonathan Bowden to explain.
The First World War is a revolution in the soul of man. He didn't think it was a war. He thought it was a climactic moment whereby machine technology invasively entered the human space. You would see 1,000 men charged towards some enclave, and 2 would be left afterwards, and their bones would be showered miles behind you because of the impact of the violence that was coming down on them. Lewis turned to people afterwards and said, this isn't a war. You know, it's something else. It's the mass industrialization of death within modernity. And he believed, as much of that generation did, that those who went through this were never the same. And one of the reasons, if you like, for the radicality of his modernism and his belief that everything should be changed is the belief of that generation, in part, that everything should be changed after what they'd been through. They weren't going to come back here and listen to the old men preaching about the same old stuff. They wanted a new world.
This new emerging man is something radically different from the bourgeois individual and the Marxist proletarian. The new man, identified archetypically as the worker, is undergoing increasing objectification, and he has shifted from seeking to avoid pain to attempting to master pain. A chthonic, heroic, and cultic world is re-emerging, something you see very obviously in his World War I memoir, Storm of Steel. In this new world, there's a new, but also very primordial notion emerging, or perhaps re-emerging, that a good life is a matter of maintaining complete control over life so that any hour of the day it can serve a higher calling. For Jünger, and also for C.S. Lewis, sacrifice is the ultimate mark of having attained complete control over life. We consider it therefore a mark of superior achievement when life gains distance from itself, or, in other words, when it is able to sacrifice itself. Despite the differences in what the books are talking about, with C.S. Lewis defending the Christian faith and Ernst Jünger proclaiming the rise of a new man in a new age, there are many similarities between these two works. They are both, for instance, disgusted with the mediocre middle class and their cowardly orientation towards pain and suffering. Jünger writes, "Since the war's end, the denial of pain as a necessary factor of life has experienced a late revival." And then a few pages later, he scoffs at the fact that today, pain is marginalized in favor of run-of-the-mill complacency, and the sum of pain that remains unclaimed and amasses as hidden capital is accruing capital interest. The threat grows with every artificial increase in the barrier separating man from the elementary forces. And likewise, Lewis says, "For about 100 years, we have been so concentrated on one of the virtues, kindness or mercy, that most of us do not feel anything except kindness to be really good or anything other than cruelty to be really bad. Every Christian must reject with detestation that covert propaganda for cruelty which tries to drive out mercy out of the world by calling it names such as humanitarianism and sentimentality." Another similarity lies in what might be tentatively called their cases for pain. For Lewis, this case has 2 main premises. The first is the self-sacrificial nature that Christians are called to undertake in order to emulate Christ. But, and here comes the second part, the human spirit will not even begin to try to surrender self-will as long as all seems to be well with it. So God, as our all-powerful and all-loving creator, can use pain to have us fulfill our destiny of uniting ourselves with him through us voluntarily and selflessly sacrificing ourselves after coming to the realization it is God whom we must rely on. Here we may think of the first of the Beatitudes, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And for Jünger, the case for pain is that the constant exposure will cause us to learn to overcome pain and not let it dictate our lives where we must live in constant fear of it. As he says, the point is to integrate pain and organize life in such a way that one is always armed against it. We will be able to turn our bodies into a command center to serve higher callings that are only available to us if pain isn't a deterrence. It is a matter of maintaining complete control over life so that at any hour of the day it can serve a higher calling. This is how the last man is overcome. This is how the new great man of Jünger's modernity is forged. A man not scared to do great things because he may get hurt or have to suffer. Someone who is able to sacrifice himself for something larger than himself. To this effect, Jünger is actually very, if only accidentally, Christian. While this claim of Jünger's work having a deeply Christian theme might sound surprising, it isn't that surprising when you see all the Christian references in his work that go beyond mere literary tropes. For instance, he talks about the martyrdom of St. Polycarp and St. Leonidas of Alexandria, who was Origen's father, and references St. John Cassian's writing on the Desert Fathers, and he has several references to Benedictine monasticism. These Christians could only become the exemplars of the faith that they are through their relationship with pain, which is antithetical to the world of today. Here I think Lewis would be in emphatic agreement. Even though Lewis approaches the subject of pain in his book differently, yet not oppositionally, I think that you can combine a Christianized Jungerian answer to the so-called problem of pain that Lewis is dealing with. Why does a loving Christian God allow a world of pain and suffering to exist? Well, because of the fall, but within this fallen world, it is allowed because pain is a tool God uses for good, despite its evil ontological origins. Pain is used so that we may learn to deal with its existential penetration of our ego, and realize that since pain is not going away, we shouldn't lead lives running away from it and chasing pleasure, but instead learn how to overcome pain through detachment of our flesh in this world so that we may expand our power and orient towards a higher goal, of course that being God. And likewise, I think we can do a Lewisian reading of Ernst Jünger, where we can better understand the phenomenological nature of pain as Jünger lays out so eloquently. But this reading of Jünger can also supplement where Lewis might be weakest in his book, namely in explaining exactly how pain can change us, something that's only touched on a few times in The Problem of Pain. Here I believe that readers of Lewis can be greatly helped by Jünger's virtually Heideggerian treatment of how pain confronts our very existence and gives us a choice to live authentically or to run away in cowardice, seeking relief in pleasure and living a very pathetic life reduced to nothing more than an animalistic pursuit of pleasure.
Das nicht schaust auf Gottes Tod, die Götter sterben, aber die Titanen werden sehr mächtig. Die Technik ist ja nur ein Kleid, eine Rüstung der Titanen. Ist der Stahlhelm, den ich in der Tankschlacht von Cambrai getragen habe. Ich gab gerade nach hinten einen Befehl, drehte mich um und bekam einen Schuss von hinten, der den Kopf streifte und vorn wieder aus dem Stahlhelm herausgefahren ist. Daneben der Stahlhelm eines englischen Offiziers, der mich an der Westfront angegriffen hat. Er bekam einen Schuss durch den Kopf. Leider ist er gefallen. Ich habe das immer wieder bedauert. Ich habe hier noch seine Feldflasche hängen und andere Andenken.